咱们这个亚洲民主联盟呢，成立了好几年了。
The founding of the Asian Democracy Alliance.
现在呢，咱们面临着很多很现实的问题。
We are faced with a lot of realistic problems and issues.
首先来讲，这个在中国的范围内，现在西藏的问题、新疆的问题都比较突出。
First of all, inside the China and we are faced with Tibetan problems and problems of Uyghurs in Xinjiang, new territory.
新疆的朋友今天是因为有特殊的原因来不了，咱们西藏朋友习惯于迟到，所以等一会儿才能来。
And friends from Xinjiang and they cannot come because of very specific issues and very Tibetan friends you know, are used to be late.
我经常说他们啊，习惯于在山上放羊看太阳，下班上班，所以啊，没有什么时间观念。
And they are may still be wandering around the mountainside and the ship the large flock of sheep.
反正他们只有昨天是提前到达，从来都是迟到，甚至有迟到三个小时，人会都开完了。
But I have to you know give them the credit that they came to the meeting place 2 hours earlier yesterday.
但是呢，现在西藏的问题、新疆的问题都有很产生很多新的情况。
And now we are faced with new issues with Tibetan problems and problems in relation to Xinjiang.
西藏呢，现在的问题呢就是。在他们内部也是很有争论，就是关于达赖喇嘛现在要回中国，然后呢，自焚的这个运动要不要持续下去？这两个问题呢是很现实也很尖锐的问题。
And we are faced with two most and sharp and difficult issues within the Tibetan resistance movement. And one is the argument arising inside Tibetan free Tibetan movement is whether Dalai Lama, His Holiness Dalai Lama, should return to China. Another one is any continue or discontinuity of the abolition movement.
这个在它内部有很多的争论。今天来的两个代表是代表民间的，不是代表藏政府的。所以我们待会儿可以听听他们的这些看法。
There are debates inside the Tibetan resistance movement, and today and there are two representatives from Tibetan movement. They are from grassroots, not representing their opinion, not representing the Tibetan exile, Tibetan government on exile.
其实，在新疆人内部呢，争论也非常尖锐。有的人现在就是赞成要搞恐怖活动，等等，但是相当多的新疆的朋友呢，他们也不赞成，所以这个在他们内部争论也很激烈。
And also there arises with sharp disputes among the infractional disputes among those Uyghur fighters, and some are advocating you know, fighting by violence, resorting to violence, some opposed to it.
咱们跟越南朋友原来咱们一直合作得非常好，但是最近的越南朋友内部呢也产生了一些问题。
We had a long friendship with friends from Vietnam, and we had a good cooperation, but these days they're also arriving.Fractional disputes among those Vietnamese fighters.
因为最近呢，这个中国政府跟越南政府他们是互相闹矛盾，互相煽动爱国主义来仇视对方，所以就产生了一些新的问题。
These days, both Vietnamese government and Chinese government are fanning up the ultranationalism and you know there are cracks between two nations.
在中国的反对派内部，没有人去支持中国政府，大家都觉得你不管怎么样，你跟越南打仗，我们是反对的。
In within the China pro-democracy movement, we have consensus. We don't have disagreement. We don't support our government. Whether or not the government, if the government involved in fight in armed conflict with the other government, with the Vietnamese government.
但是我注意到，在越南的反对派内部有两个不同的意见，而且支持政府的爱国主义的意见还非常多，非常强。
But I have noticed that there are two major different opinions inside the Vietnamese resistance movement, and the majority is on the government side in support of Vietnamese government to fight with Chinese government, and the minority is oppose such ultra-nationalism.
所以我从去年我参加越南朋友的活动的时候，都就呼吁他们，两个政府，他们两个共产党政府，两个魔鬼打架，我们不要去帮助任何一方，我们自己要团结在一起，我们民主派要团结在一起。
I advocated and persuaded offer my opinion to Vietnamese friends. We are not sided with any side.When two satans, two communist satans are fighting each other.
所以你看，我们这个联盟内部呢，也有很多的问题，新的问题，随着形势的发展，都需要我们来讨论一下，坐在一起解决它。
With the growth, drastic development of the situation, and we need to sit down to discuss all those newly emerged issues within the alliance.
对越南朋友来说，就是要不要去响应越南政府的爱国主义号召；对西藏朋友来说，就是说，民间和藏政府、达赖喇嘛是不是非要采取一致的立场？包括新疆的朋友，他们是不是非得要去搞恐怖主义，还是搞其他什么？我觉得，包括很多宗教界的朋友，都有各自的看法，需要大家在一起讨论。
We need to sit down to discuss about those newly emerged issues, such as should we Vietnamese or Chinese are supportive to the government, in fanning up the ultra-nationalism, and should the grassroots level Tibetan people should be in concert with the upper level Tibetan government on exile, and should Uyghur people take a violent struggle, or they have other options, other way around to fight for freedom?
我觉得我们这个亚洲民主联盟一贯的立场就是，我们亚洲各个国家的这个民主派这朋友要团结在一起，来实现我们亚洲的民主化。但是我们不要去上了各国政府的这个圈套，不要去支持各国政府，不管他们在做什么。
We have taken consistent position that members within the Asian Democracy Alliance and should fight against its own government, totalitarian government.And we shall join our hands together to build up the democracy throughout Asia.
另外就是说，我们做任何事情也要有我们的分寸，不能尤其是对新疆的朋友说，不要去搞恐怖主义，特别不要去伤害老百姓，不管他是汉族的还是维族的。
We have been consistently taken measured fighting strategy.And it's my personal opinion and persuading people, friends from Uyghur nation in Xinjiang, and we persuaded them not to take the form of terrorism in fighting for freedom, and don't do anything to harm innocent people.
不管你是西藏还是新疆，你要独立的话，你不可能在没有汉族老百姓的帮助下，你就能成功的独立，对不对？
My consistent position is, if you want to achieve your independence, you cannot achieve that goal without support from Han, Mandarin majority people in China.
包括越南的朋友也要看到，别看他们煽动爱国主义，但是实际上中国的共产党和越南的共产党，他们在大多数情况下都在一起合作，咱们才是他们要共同对付的敌人，咱们不能被他们破坏了咱们的团结。
And I also told my friends from Vietnam, and even if don't take the position as ultranationalism stood up by your own government, and for the most of time when are facing with the common enemy, fighting for freedom, the two governments are in collusion together.
人们有的时候情绪会比较高涨，会比较热情，有点过分，但是呢，我们从策略上一定要注意我们自己民主派内部的我们的团结，我们的团结在一起才能够实现亚洲民主化。如果我们都分裂了，去搞一些不适当的活动的话，我想共产党他们会很高兴。
People can sometimes be emotional and lose reason, but we must be very clear-headed, and we must unite together tightly, and we have common enemy, that's the Communist Party.
在这方面，我觉得西藏的朋友还比较有理智，他们基本上没有犯什么政治上的大的错误。
Through the practice of the alliance, I found that people from Tibet are very reasonable, rational, and they normally don't make any political poor judgment, political mistake.
而海外的新疆人的组织呢，我觉得他们现在已经在错误的道路上越走越远。他们就是以民族主义为号召，希望能够发动恐怖活动，驱赶汉族人，将来他们可以独立。我觉得这是很严重的错误。
And I found people from Xinjiang, they are slippery and more and more deeply, and they are living under the illusion that they can achieve their independence by fighting against all Han Chinese.
现在我要表扬一下洛桑啊，他终于只迟到了20分钟。
I want to give the credit to Mr. Luck Sang, and he's only being late for 20 minutes.
接着刚才话题啊，就是说，咱们各个反对派组织一定要保持我们互相之间的团结，而这个团结不是非常容易，所以我们在座的朋友们，大家一起要努力，要巩固这个团结，避免我们内部有什么分裂。
I call for unity of all dissidential opposition factions. We shall unite like one, and with all unification, and we can fight against we can beat our enemy.
由于你们迟到了，所以我还得再浪费3分钟时间，讲一下刚才我说的西藏的什么问题。
Because of you are coming a little bit late, so I will spend 3 more minutes repeating what I told about Tibet moments before.
就是现在西藏的这个海外流亡组织啊，我等你，又浪费1分钟。
Another minute is lost.
那个现在西藏的海外流亡的组织，其实也包括国内的藏人啊，也面临着一个变局，一个很复杂的局面。
Tibetans outside China on exile are also faced with very complicated situation because of development in China.
一个是达赖喇嘛要回这个中国去五台山。
Number one is His Holiness Dalai Lama.Wants to visit China, going to Wutai Mountains, Buddhist.
我记得10年前我就当面警告过他，千万不要回去，共产党花招非常多。他跟我说，老魏，我没那么傻。
About ten years ago, I always told Dalai Lama and offering my opinion that never go back to China. The Chinese Communist party is very cunning, very, you know, they know how to play a lot of games.
但是看来呢，有很多人在做他的工作，在替共产党做他的工作。现在他终于耐不住，他要回去了。那么你们所有的藏民就面临一个问题：他回去被共产党控制了以后，大家怎么办？这是你们面临的一个难题。
Now, it is clear that many peoples are working, to persuade, to exert influence upon His Holiness to go back to China and to, you know, just for the Chinese Communist agenda. And now you are faced with a new issue. What if His Holiness were detained by a Chinese Communist government? And what to be done, you know, in the vacancy, in the vacuum left by departure of His Holiness Dalai Lama?
第二个很严重的问题就是这个自焚已经延续了好几年，死了100多人了。那么这个自焚显然没有达到预期的想的效果。那么这件事儿要不要继续下去，包括将来怎么收场，这对整个藏人社区来讲也是一个很严重的问题。
Another very grave issue is the abolition has been in place for almost more than 2 years. And more than 100 people, the mothers, has dedicated their lives already. And how to end this abolition movement didn't attract sufficient and enough international attention. So how to continue or discontinue the abolition movement, that's also a very serious issue. You guys need to be considered seriously.
第三个问题很重要，非常重要。就是说，虽然流亡社区的那个民主化已经有了一点进步，从这个政教合一的民主进步到了还要选举的民主。当然，这个选举你们西藏人最清楚，它不是真正的。那么下边西藏的民主化要怎么发展，这也是很严重的问题。
And issue number three is that the government on exile for the Tibetan peoples has achieved considerable progress in fighting for freedom and independence. However, and now the movement has achieved the kind of separation between religion and sacred issues, and so and secular issues. But now, with the some split between the government and the movement on grassroots level, you guys may also need to consider how to you know, make it greater and strength you know, more powerful.
我们的翻译累了，先换一下，休息休息吧。那个最后一句话，关于西藏问题，我还是要重复，我一再跟洛桑跟你们的西藏朋友讲了很多次的，就是千万不要学新疆人去搞恐怖主义，千万不要搞，我们要把给西藏的事业呢增加阻力，所以这个千万不要做。
So Mr. Wei was saying that, you know, the Tibetan society has moved from once the religion and the political system were the same into the different, into the current stage, but obviously there's more room to improve. And the last thing he thinks most important is do not do something like to kick the Han Chinese out, or do not take any violent approaches, because that will not be good to yourself as well.
所以总的来说，我对西藏的希望就是大家能够在海外迅速的把这个比较成熟的民主制度建立起来，这样对国内的藏民才有真正的号召力，不能永远只靠达赖喇嘛来号召，那个东西是有限的。特别你们最近从国内出来的人讲，都明白，这个东西对年轻人来说号召力已经没有那么强了。你看，
So anyway, either way, the Mr. Wei said that, you know, the very important thing is for you to have a democratic society yourself instead of rely on His Holiness the Dalai Lama to take the leadership for you. And this is the most important thing. And also, there is change in the Tibetan society, and you should know what the younger people want. And that's what, you know, that's younger people want. And what it was before is not very appealing to the younger people anymore.
迅速地把那个藏人社区这个群众组织发展成政党，发展成反对派政党，而不是什么都听那个藏政府的。我讲这点是应付达赖喇嘛去北京去中国以后的很好的一个措施。
To rapidly develop the opposition parties to have a true democracy with the Tibetan community, I think that's maybe the best measure to move the Tibetan society to democracy, and especially after the Dalai Lama went back to China.
所以我就讲这么多，待会儿我希望你们谈谈你们就这几个问题的看法。
So that's what I want to say, and I'm looking forward to what you have to say later on about Tibet.
好，现在下面主持人。
Okay, so that's a long opening remarks, but I think it's very important, very well summarized what we have been progress in regarding Asian Democracy Alliance in the past 8 years.Next one, we welcome Ms. Delphine Helgen, and she's the director of Reporter Without the Borders, USA, and she's really know everything, but we will have her concentrate to give an overview of about the Asian democracy and the freedom situation in general. Then we could open up for each specialist to talk about that. Thank you.
Thank you. So good afternoon, everybody. Of course, I would like to thank you, Xinping, but Mr. Wei and all the Wen Jingqing Foundation for organizing the wonderful exhibition, the award ceremony yesterday, and today's seminar with the Asia Democracy Alliance.If you need me to do the translation in French, I can do it too. I don't know if
necessary.
Reporters Without Borders USA is very honored to be one of the co-sponsors of this event, and I really would like to thank you all for joining us today. For those of you who don't know Reporters Without Borders, Reporters Without Borders was funded 30 years ago to defend journalists and freedom of information all around the world.We are able to do that thanks to an amazing network of 150 correspondents reporting in 130 countries to help us to report on press freedom violation every day and to assist journalists and citizen journalists on the ground. So today I'm thinking especially of these journalists that we are helping from Somalia to Mexico andespecially in Asia. I'm thinking of the 180 journalists and 175 citizen journalists who are now in jail all over the world. You know better than I do that China and Vietnam are the top biggest prison for news providers, and following these countries, we can find countries like Eritrea, Syria, Iran, Ethiopia, and Uzbekistan.Today, I'm thinking especially of the 104 news providers in prison in China, like Gao Yu or Ilham Toti. China is ranked at the 175th position in the latest Reporters Without Borders World Press Freedom Index. Despite having an astonishingly vital and increasingly militant blogosphere, China continues to censor and jail.Dissidents, bloggers, and journalists. The other Asia giant is also facing major concern. India is now ranked at the 140th position in Reporters Without Borders World Press Freedom Index. India experienced an unprecedented wave of violence against journalists. Last year, 8 journalists were killed in India, which is the highest number than in Pakistan. Journalists are targeted in India by both state and non-state actors. Almost no region is spared, but Kashmir and Chhattisgarh continue to be the only two states where violence and censorship are endemic. Those responsible for threats and physical violence against journalists who are often abandoned by the judicial system and forced to censor themselves include police and security forces, as well as criminal groups or political party supporters. Vietnam is now at the 174th position. Vietnam has stepped by information control to the point of being very close to catching up with its Chinese big brother. Independent news providers are subject to enhanced internet surveillance, draconian directive like the Article 88 or Section 1 of Article 79. Waves of arrest, sham trials are the common law. Vietnam continues to be the world's second largest prison for bloggers. There are at least 27 bloggers currently detained, and most of them were arrested since Nguyen Phu Trong became the party's general secretary in January 2011. Vietnam's bloggers are a source of independently reported news and information that is an alternative to the government media propaganda. Bloggers in Vietnam write about corruption, environment problems, and the country's political development. The party in Vietnam took censorship to a new level in September 2013, just 1 year ago, when it issued a new decree, the Decree 72, banning the use of blogs and social networks to share information about news development. It is now forbidden in Vietnam to share news on the social networks. It shows that the party is waging an all-out offensive against the new generation internet, which is seen as a dangerous counterweight to the domestic or traditional media. Today, I'm also thinking of the situation in Hong Kong. As mainland China steps up its effort to suppress information about the pro-democracy protest in Hong Kong, the online censorship monitoring website GreatFire.org, has reported that several international media censored their own coverage in the initial stages, at least. By example, the protests were on the lead stories on the English language website of Reuters and the Wall Street Journal, but their Chinese version did not mention them on September 28. The Wall Street Journal Chinese version began covering them after 24 hours, while Reuters' Chinese version did not cover the protest in Hong Kong for at least 48 hours. When GreatFire.org pointing this out, the Wall Street Journal editor Gerald Becker and this editor of the Chinese service, Li Yuan, responded with tweets denying any self-censorship and listing articles about China it had published earlier in the month, before the protest started. And Reuters didn't answer to GreatFire.org. We are very disturbed by the increasing tendency of certain foreign media to censor their coverage of Hong Kong, because it reflects an increase in the regime grips of an information channel that one would have supposed to be less vulnerable to interference by the local authorities. This is a trend that has been seen for some years. In addition to description by Hong Kong journalists of the self-censorship prevailing within their own news organization, there has been a growing number of editorial decisions by foreign media that are, to say the least, surprising and are usually the result of constant pressure from the government in Beijing. The foreign media must not submit to blackmail by the Chinese authorities and, on the contrary, should spearhead the resistance against censorship. Photos of the Occupy Central movement have reached the mainland, although the Chinese authorities have blocked the photo sharing website Instagram, and of course certain keywords on Weibo. At the same time, a completely different take has been given on the events. The demonstration in Hong Kong were either portrayed in the Chinese media as a handful of extremists disturbing public order, or simply a gathering in anticipation of the Chinese national holiday on October 1st. Activists have been inventive, of course, in their efforts to circumvent the censorship, using alternative words to replace those blocked by Beijing. The application, by example, FireChat, was reportedly downloaded more than 100,000 times in 24 hours because of its decentralized system that prevents any censorship. The universal suffrage, which Hong Kong had been promised and which was supposed to end Chinese interference in its internal politics, seems increasingly out of reach. The decline in media freedom in Hong Kong is part of the regime's increasing repression. And freedom of information, as we define it at Reporters Without Borders, is clearly one of the most important freedoms, because freedom of information is the freedom which allows all of us to verify the existence of all other freedom. And at Reporters Without Borders, we will continue to fight for this freedom to allow all of us to verify the existence or not of the freedoms in Hong Kong, in China, in Vietnam, in India, and so on. And we are very proud to continue this fight with you. Thank you.
Excuse me. Our next speaker is Professor Shen Ye, and he always he's very active to promote the human rights and freedom. And he's a professor and chairman of mechanical engineering at the Catholic University of America. And he's going to talk about the Hong Kong and the Taiwan students' demonstration and the Chinese people's tweet down means quit the Communist Party movement. Thank you, Professor Ye.
Fellow Asian and ethnic leaders and activists, friends of Asian, and ladies and gentlemen. I'm very honored to be invited to give a brief remark at this seminar on Asia in Hong Kong. I was asked to prepare the speech in English, so I'll give the remarks in English. I'd like to commend Wei Jingsheng Foundation and the Asian Democracy Alliance for your timely efforts and leadership of organizing today's event to raise the awareness of the ongoing protest in Hong Kong and China's and the current situation in Asia at the U.S. Congress. We appreciate this platform of gathering, and we stand in solidarity with you all in fighting for freedoms, human rights, and democracy for Hong Kong, China, and other Asian countries and ethnic groups. Today, I want to share with you three messages about China that could affect you in the near future. The first is people's choice in Hong Kong and Taiwan. Mm-hmm. And second is the Tuidang movement of Chinese people in China. And the third is what to do in the times of coming collapse of Chinese Communist Party. First, the protest of students and people in Hong Kong and Taiwan. As tens of thousands of protesters gathers on streets of Hong Kong, the city we call the Oriental Pearl, Dongfang Minzu, for the seventh day now. Their demand for the right to choose their leaders in fully democratic elections, and their resistance to communist systems, so-called the umbrella revolution. It's for the protesters use the umbrellas to shield against paper spread and tear gas from armed policemen. This recent series of protests in Hong Kong was triggered by a white paper China's State Council Information Office published on June 10th. Just like torn up the Hong Kong's basic law, one country, two systems, 一国两制. Why there was one country, two systems for Hong Kong's returning to China in 1997? Why not one country, one system? It was clear that Hong Kong people knew, Chinese people knew, and communist ruling elites knew that communist system is not good.
Yes.
Not acceptable to Hong Kong.
Yes.
So there's a one country, two systems. So another perspective of looking at Hong Kong's umbrella revolution, which many speakers will talk about, is Hong Kong students and people want one country, two systems.
Yes.
Want free democratic systems. They resist and discard communist dictator ruling, communist systems, and communism. That's another way to look at the Hong Kong protests today. When tens of thousands of student protests last March in Taipei, so-called the Sunflower Movement, 太阳花运动, I witnessed this movement while I took sabbatical in Taiwan for 6 months. Students occupied the legislative yuan, 立法院, protest and passing the cross-strait service trade agreement by the ruling party Kuomintang without representatives clause by clause review in this under table behind the door. Students and people in Taiwan perceive this under table secret agreements with communists in trade pact hurt Taiwan's economy and leave the vulnerable to political pressure from Beijing. So another perspective of looking at Taiwan's Sunflower Movement is Taiwan students and people resist the close association with communists and in a similar way discard communist ruling, communist system, and communism. Last month, thousands of people gathered in Kharkov town square to witness and to dance and to celebrate the Ukraine's largest Lenin statues torn down and destroyed. In the past few years, Polish government initiates and work hard on the decommunization, 去共化, for the country, namely cleansing the communist symbols, books, items, street names, statues, the Polish government and people discarding the Communist Party culture and prosecute the communist criminals and commemorating the victims of communism. I also learned from my Vietnamese friend that there were 30 or more military generals in Vietnam quit the Communist Party of Vietnam as a group last year. There is a subtle but widespread, massive global trend awakening of discarding the communism and communist rulings and systems, just like Hong Kong and Taiwan. Number two, trade-downs of people in China. While most people in the world have enjoyed their freedoms and human rights, over 2 billion people living in China, Laos, North Korea, Vietnam,
etc. in Asia still suffer from human rights violations. The same agony and nightmare of evil communist ruling and struggle for their basic rights, freedom. Throughout the 20th century, the communists were marked with lies, tyranny, starvation, torture, massacre, and death in our homeland. In 65 years of ruling, Chinese Communist Party has caused unnatural death of 80 million citizens. This doesn't count 400 million unborn babies through forced abortions in China in the last 34 years. This 80 million people is more than the total life death of 5,000 years of Chinese history. Plus, this is more than the deaths of casualty of World War I plus World War II combined. 80 million Chinese innocent people die. If they hold hands together, they can wrap around the equator of the earth six turns.
Six turns.
This is how communists treat their people in the peaceful time. But today I want to share with you how Chinese have determined to make changes, seek for their conscious awakenings, and pursue the freedom and basic rights they long deserved, while communists are still in power. The so-called Tuida movement, Quit Communist Party's movement, Tuidang Da Cao. Since the publication of an editorial series, Nine Commentaries on the Communist Party, Zhou Ping Gong Chan Dang, by the Epoch Times in 2004, the power of truth awakens tens of thousands of brainwashed Chinese each and every day from all over China to denounce their tie with communists, a peaceful, massive movement to quit the Communist Party. More and more ordinary Chinese citizens dare to stand up and say no to Chinese Communist Party. Up to today, there have been 179 million courageous Chinese has publicly denounced their tie with Chinese Communist Party. Then they put their statement of withdrawal posted on the public websites, the Tuidang website. For example, the last summer, in 3 months, there were 9,133,000 Chinese Tuidang in 3 months. The Tuidang movement at a rate of 3 million withdrawal per month, 100,000 per day, 70 withdrawal per minute, more than one person per second, every second, 24 hours, seven. Or in this 3 hours of seminar, there will be another 12,500 courageous Chinese quit the Communist Party.
Right.
Three, learning truth and make choice while Communist Party is collapsing. In addition to the corruptions, unemployment, deteriorating environments, ecosystems, the Communist regime in China today faces with large number and large scale protests and demonstrations like Hong Kong, like Taiwan earlier. According to the authority of Chinese government, there are more than 2,000 reports of security problems, more than 500 demonstrations of group conflicts, which means more than 50% involved, and each and every day in China. So it's about one large-scale protest with more than 5,000 bitter citizens and more than 50 bloody crackdowns happen every day in China. Chinese Communist Party is sitting on the top of live volcano. It was reported for the last 4 years in a row, the budget spending used on public security, so-called Weiwen, for cracking down its own people has exceeded the military budget spending in China in the last 4 years. This means that Communist China is definitely not a harmonious society. And the Chinese people are being treated by Communist Party as number one enemy. Last year, more than half of the real estate house in the state of California were bought by rich people from China. 70% of them bought a house in cash. Many cities in the United States and Canada have their escaped home, the so-called China villages. There have been millions of communist officials from China and family members fleeing the country each and every day in the past 20 years. The ruling elites are also not comfortable and resist communist system themselves. They are leaving the country, they vote by their two legs. They are fleeing and running scared each and every day from China. So the Chinese Communist Party is coming to collapse soon, very soon. But don't forget, before this disintegration, people inside the regime can always choose to learn more about the truth, to wake up from the brainwashed illusion, the Communist Party culture, to go against the persecutions upon them, to fight for their own freedoms and basic rights. Thank you. Keep up with your good work. Wish you seminars and events every success.
Our next speaker will be Henry Hengqing Li. He's the director of the Chinese Scholar Friendship Association. He's going to talk about Empire Dream of China is a huge challenge to democracy society. And 这下面是李恒清先生他讲要讲的就是说他是驻华学人联谊会执行理事，他要讲是中国的帝国梦是对民主社会的一个巨大挑战。谢谢。
I was asked to speak in English, so I think so many people are Chinese speakers.
Feel free.
Yeah,
you could use multi-language
and French. Yeah, do you think I can speak Chinese?
Mandarin?
Yeah, Mandarin.
you could speak, I'll give a brief English.
Okay.
You
can
speak Latin or French.
Okay, 我其实刚才听到这个吴先生讲呢，确实是很感人的一个 sad story。其实我倒觉得我今天呢想就是很短呢，但是我想呢跟大家呢分享一个最近呢我们一直在讨论的一个问题。其实中国的问题现在呢已经不再是像大家现在所说的像是共产主义运动和资本主义的这个竞争，已经不再是那个了。现在共产党他们还说他们自己是共产党，但实际上已经不再是共产党，他们在不再坚持原来是马克思主义或者列宁主义的共产党了。像我在将近30年前嘛，我也是曾经是共产党员高中的时候就入党，后来呢当然走到另外一个方向去了。所以现在的真正的问题我们现在大家都在看，实际上是一个专制政府或者是专制的这么一个权力跟一个民主社会在竞争，这个呢是现在的这个问题的这个核心的一个问题。所以现在呢大家都可以看到，在现在呢这个中国呢这个 苏联呢现在呢占了这个克里米亚，然后呢中国呢这个习近平就说呢，说我们永远不会参与制裁苏联。所以大家就可以看到他们实际上呢这个独裁国家在联合，在逐渐在联合起来，他要跟这种民主国家呢对抗。 这个是一个现在的社会的一个最核心的一个竞争一个战争。所以呢，我觉得啊，这才是我们现在必须要明确的一个问题。这就是我们在座的这些人和更多的西方的这些政治家们要去做的一件事情。像我们经常啊，比如像我去跟那个 NED， 美国民主基金会有时候去讨论问题哈、啊，他们的官员就很明确说你如果你要去跟国务院的官员去讨论问题，你要小心。为什么？因为他们都很随境，他们呢都有很多这些官员呢都有很多 relationship 在中国，他们可以到中国去做共同的研究啊、合作项目啊。为什么？因为他们用中国政府可以变相的来行贿，但实际上这里都牵扯到他们个人的利益的时候，他们就用脚表决了，实际上是一样的。在国会，在这个 building 里头，有很多的这些国会议员，他们也一样在用脚表决啊。所以这个是一个核心的一个问题。所以作为我们来说，现在共产主义运动，实际上我觉得已经不是一个我们需要去反对它的一个问题。我们现在需要就是用最基本的民主和人权作为一个武器，对吧？那个时候，共产党可能就变成了八九年的时候了。90年的时候是吧？我们那时候我还在监狱里。89年底，90年初，是吧？突然一天我们就不许听广播了，不许看报纸了。后来过了两天以后，再打一看，哎呦，说怎么乔塞斯库被打死了，对吧？哎，真就是一夜之间就变了，可能不可能？完全有可能。所以现在我说我们就做什么？就做两件事就可以。另外一个，当然了，我说也是一个笑话了啊。我的同学，我的学弟，在这个 Facebook 上，就在我的帖子后边跟了一个，说你不是想声援吗？到香港来呀。他在香港。后来呢，我说我去不了。哎，他马上就一个，你就是动动手啊，我们要在这儿等着被抓。哎呀，心里头可搓火了，对吧？但是你一想啊，就是要。只要我能做什么，我就做。这才是我们真正的中国梦。这是我们，只有我们这么做，中国的梦，中国人自己的梦就不可能实现了。所以我就说这些。
Thank you very much. I'll give a very quick English translation. But he's good in English, so I hope I stop me or correct me if I misrepresented your talk. But I really like his, you know, Mr. Lee is a former student leader in 1989 democracy movement. And for this reason, he was sent to prison. And I like his talk because he talked a lot about taking actions, using of social media. He talked about like recently his communication with his schoolmate in Hong Kong, you know, and talk about this situation, you know, what, you know, this is a very tricky situation which I felt very strongly the same, that when we support the people in Hong Kong, and we are really supporting ourselves. He talked about one particular situation when he was in jail and after 1989 democracy movement. And one day, suddenly, he's not allowed to listen to the radio or read the newspaper. It turned out it was the Ceausescu of Romania got killed. So it was just so dramatic. So he refined what we could do to take action. That's most important, and I agree. And in his early speech, he also talked about, there is a problem that in the past we're talking about communists, but in nowadays, I think the same situation with the Vietnamese community is the communist has switched. They become more for their own benefit, an interest group, and so therefore there is this difference. So he's talking about now our issue is really a
fight between democracy and dictators. And so therefore, it's more than ever the dictators are united together in a way like recently Xi Jinping was answering the issue of Crimea, and Xi Jinping said, oh, we are not going to interfere because they are really on the same bank, the same wagon. So therefore, I think again we come to back to this alliance issue. We have to get together. When the dictators are united together, we have to be get together and unite together. Then we are powerful enough. So he also talked about in Hong Kong when the situation, you know, if the situation in Hong Kong, if northeast of China has uprising, then you could imagine it will encouraging people in Beijing uprising. You know, this collapse, this domino effect could be very quickly reached if we're all doing our share. So I really think that was an excellent talk. So our last one for the first half of the panel is by Luke Shen. He even have a Chinese name called Li Ke Xian, and he's a Tibetan writer and an activist from India. And my understanding, he's very popular with the Tibetan community. And he's going to talk about Tibetan against tyranny. And they also supported the democracy demand of the people in Hong Kong. 那下面一个呢，就是我们那个西藏朋友哈，他的他是一个作家和活动家，叫李克先，他是要谈藏人反抗暴政和支持香港人民的民主诉求。 And amazingly, because he has a Chinese name, maybe. So he also speak Chinese.
Right.
他因为有中国名字, and then I'll give a brief English.
Thank you, 给大家做一个报告，我特别高兴，谢谢。那这个，怎么讲吧？韦金生先生在1974年替那个时代民主墙的那个海报的时候，大概是74年75年吧。对，七几年，对，那时候我可能三四岁，哎，因为呢。 所谓这个有了这种老魏的这种精神吧，所谓我今天站在这里也是这个精神的部分，我可以说，那我想呢怎么说呢，在我们西藏人要支持这个香港的这个学运，这个和这些香港的这个环保的这个，我们当然要支持。 但是我个人来说的话，我特别喜欢这个 umbrella revolution， 特别是我喜欢这个 revolution 这个词，因为，但是很多西藏人就是不太喜欢听这个 revolution 这个词，因为把共产党这么好的一个词已经用毁了，是用毁了，因为西藏人一怕。 一听就是这个revolution 这个词，解放这个词，西藏人能听出来这是一个毁灭性的灾难。所以呢，西藏人很害怕，他们西藏人相对比较喜欢这个 evolution， 或者是比较复古的那种想法。但是我个人来说的话，我很喜欢这个 revolution， 我们需要一个真正的 revolution。哎，这个世界上我们真的需要一个 revolution。 现在中国也是面临着一个 revolution， 但是我个人在那个坐牢，在监狱里面待的时候，共产党把我判的时候呢，我的罪名是反革命，anti revolution 什么的，但是呢，我当时也问过，什么叫反革命？共产党当初搞革命的时候。 共产党是我们说的话，我大家都知道，他是搞革命起家的
这么一个党。那你的革命是合法，为什么我的革命是不合法呢？啊，革命不是共产党的专利，对啊，大家都有革命的权利。所以呢，就是我就喜欢这个革命这两个词。对，这是第一个啊。第二个呢，我再都不讲这个什么西藏的这个反抗，或者是这个讲的话，这个故事太多了，因为一下子就讲不出来。我给大家简单的说两句，特别是刚才老魏讲的这个关于达赖喇嘛回归就这个事情上，现在的实际上的这个各大报纸都报道这个达赖喇嘛回归。或者是要访问五台山什么的，这是一个关于西藏的一个大的新闻。但是这里面刚才老魏说的一样，大家都害怕达赖喇嘛回去了，这个是不是躲在监狱里面啊？或者是达赖喇嘛共产党在怎么利用这一点上，大家都担心这个。我个人来说的话，李小宝在那个监狱里面前两段把我们大家都知道中央民大的教授伊利哈姆教授，他就判了一个什么无期徒刑啊。如果这种情况下共产党可能把达赖喇嘛回归吗？我说这是逻辑上的一个大的问题，我觉得是不可能。但是共产党一直抹黑吧达赖喇嘛的，这个现在继续在抹黑可是呢，西藏刚才也说了，西藏境内137个人在自焚，他们自焚的很多人的这个遗言里面留着有达赖喇嘛有回归，达赖喇嘛有回家。那这一点上来说的话，那共产党这个控制这个居民怎么控制呢？这一点上达赖喇嘛有一个利用价值，并不是把达赖喇嘛的这个理念共产党就解释了。因为共产党在没办法自焚的人一起都不怕了，共产党手里有枪，自焚的人就不怕死，共产党里面手里有钱，拿这两个来共产党这个控制西藏，自焚的人当然不要钱，那很简单。这样的话共产党实在没办法了，那就是有达赖喇嘛有教会来，或者给地里面摆一个什么一个假的什么一个植物，或者是这样的，这个可能性比较大。因为西藏的居民相对来说在实在没办法控制了，这一点上以前共产党所谓的现在就是有香港回归，用这个词很难听，西藏人也就用了这个什么西藏这个祖国的回报里面说回归的时候，共产党的口号是革命，当然是西藏需要和平解放啊什么的，用这些词。但是呢，那时候大家都知道达赖喇嘛和班禅喇嘛都是有利用的价值，所谓共产党把革命的党政教合一的领袖摆在那个什么人大常委委员会的什么委员长副委员长这里的，这个可能吗？这个不是小话吗？革命的政党把这么分金拢路柱放到他们的人大常委会的副委员长去了呢？但是这样来说过一句话，你们西藏需要这样的立者，你们需要这样的什么时候领导我们西藏人需要这样的力量吗？刚才韦先生说的一样，我们需要的就是真正的一个革命啊，我们需要的一个政教分离啊，政教合一的国家大家都知道，政教合一不是一个好东西，我们西藏人亲身感觉到的一个东西嘛。但是共产党把辟谣政教合一的例子拿过来给我们当例子，他知道那个什么胡锦涛啊什么王健涛啊这些都是再不起作用了，所以这个他把这个政教合一的例子放在那地方。所以这样的话，我觉得这个方面有一些利用价值的话，共产党利用一切的 这一点上也许有点可能性，但是呢，如果达赖喇嘛不管是怎么说，现在这种情况下达赖喇嘛回去的话，那这个不是一个好事，我可以这么说啊，这不是一个好事。其他的呢，对，在香港的这一块我刚才也讲了，现在我继续讲到这里，谢谢大家给我提供这个机会。
I think Mr. Wei said that I will give some additional inputs on that.
我们在国外啊，很多朋友总是听说达赖喇嘛，西藏人全都信喇嘛教，都成一个习惯的看法了。
So people, we are overseas, outside China, we heard since say, oh, talk about Dalai Lama, all the Tibetan believe.The Tibetan Buddhism is almost like habit.
其实共产党也是这么看的，他们觉得我们把班禅喇嘛或者达赖喇嘛控制在手里，那西藏人就老实了。
And that's what in the mind of the communist leaders in China too. They think, okay, if we could control the Dalai Lama and control the Panchen Lama, then we got settled with Tibetans' affairs.
其实十几年前。我给胡耀邦，84年都不是十几年前，20年前了，给胡耀邦写信的时候就跟他讲过，其实对于藏族老百姓来说，他跟别的民族老百姓一样，他们的生活好不好，他们是不是受压迫，这是最重要的。
So 30 years ago, when I wrote letters to the communist leader.That time was Hu Yaobang. I told him, I said, what matters most to the Tibetan people? And it's that if they have a good life.
然后十多年以前吧，我跟达赖喇嘛自己也讲过，我说如果你不推动一个民主的政治，给西藏老百姓一个新的希望的话，你光靠这个政教合一，你将来回不了西藏的。现在没有那么多人，把你当神，对不对？
So even more than 10 years ago, when I met with the Dalai Lama, I talked to him. I said, look, you cannot really, the Tibetan, you know, you cannot really return to Tibet. And if you do not become a democratic, if you still let this situation, all the situation of the religious and politics to be the same.
而且对很多的西藏的老百姓来讲，政教合一并不是一个很好的选择。这个大家其实都明白。
As a matter of fact, even the Tibetans understand that it's not a good idea when the political power and religion is overlapping to each other.
所以十几年来，达赖喇嘛本人是有意识的在推动流亡社区的民主化。
So for more than 10 years now, including His Holiness the Dalai Lama himself has tried very hard to push the Tibetan community in exile to be democratic.
但是呢，在这个流亡政府里，还是有很多既得利益者，他们反对流亡社区的民主化，他们在对抗老百姓和达赖喇嘛的愿望。
However, still there are some interest group within the Tibetan government in exile, and they are still trying to resist the idea of democratic against the will of His Holiness Dalai Lama.
所以大家不要以为所有西藏人都是一模一样的。其实西藏流亡社区，包括国内的藏区的藏民，他们的思想也是很复杂的。不全都是说，什么都听达赖喇嘛的。
So we should realize that it's not that simple within the Tibetan community itself. As a matter of fact, within the Tibetan community in exile, as well as the Tibetan community inside of China, they really have a different idea. They have a complicated thoughts, not what we maybe perceive as very simple and straightforward.
所以我觉得。在西藏社会里，不管是主要是流亡社会吧，这个推动民主化，建立这个一套民主制度，这个才是将来西藏希望。独立不独立那个再说，那是将来以后的事儿。现在你也反正也独立不了，但是很重要一点，怎么样建立起民主化？独立是我们的口号，我们就坚持下去，没有错。不要老搞什么跟共产党谈判，你谈了多少年，叫人家给侮辱的够呛，你谈什么谈呀？
So indeed, I strongly felt it's very important for the Tibetan community, especially Tibetan community in exile, to try to realize democracy, to be true democratic. And instead of just think of issues like independence, because the reality is in independence is not that straightforward.
10几年以前我就提醒过达赖喇嘛，就是说你允许你们藏民社会的这个反对派，其实对你是增加你的力量，不是减轻你的力量。反过来，你跟共产党谈判，你手里要有牌，你手里没有牌，你凭什么跟共产党谈判
？So the so Tibetan independence, you know, the issues people are talking about independence or not, and then they talking about do they negotiate with the Communist Party or not? The reality is, Communist Chinese Communist has been taken this as advantage to them, and they have been cheating. On the Tibetan government and the Dalai Lama, and that's really foolish. So if you want to I have advised His Holiness the Dalai Lama, it's very important, it's good to yourself to have an opposition. When you have an opposition in the Tibetan community, then you have true card in your hands in dealing with the communists. Otherwise, all you could do is follow what the communists want. That's very important.
所以海外的民主派，西藏的这个流亡的民主派，你们要有很强的反对派的面貌。哪怕将来达赖喇嘛去中国被共产党控制，你们也可以继续你们西藏人的事业。不会因为达赖喇嘛被共产党控制，你们就真的藏人全都跟着共产党走。所以民主化非常重要，现在是你的关键。
So I think indeed the democracy, democratic politics in the Tibetan community is very important because even one day, if you could become a democratic, if you have a true opposition, then even one day.His Holiness Dalai Lama returned to China, you could still become a true voice of Tibetans and thus to push for the democracy and for the better future in Tibet. The first half session of half panel. Oh, sure, okay, you know.
王复兴先生，这个上来这个给大家发言。
这个台下没什么人了。
没有，
重要的人都在，
主要成员都在。
这个我这个题目是欧洲支持中国和香港的民主化过程中能发挥的作用。这个题目比较大啊，我虽然是从欧洲来的。我现在呢，就是说想利用这点有限的时间呢，就是简单的介绍一下，就是说我自己所接触，就是，就跟香港有关的啊，这个所做过的一些工作。那么在去年的10月，也就是现在的时间，受这个联席会议跟这个林金生先生委托，我去了一次香港。当时因为我们正开完这个田纳西会议，我们在会上呢，就是提出了一个。就是习文式的口号叫改革已死，革命当立。那么我就是把这个会议的精神和我们对当时形势的认识就是传达给在我有限的范围之内传达给香港各界朋友，当时也是受魏先生委托。那么我当时接触了香港各界以后呢，当时给我的感觉是，首先当时泛民不是很团结，他们一个对这个中国政府还寄予很大希望，然后有一部分人呢还就是，对于这个战中能发展到什么程度，能达到什么这个效果，不是很有信心，当然也有一部分这个立场态度比较坚决的。这个朋友当时就是表示说，让老魏和海外朋友这个放心，我们会坚持到最后。我们这个深刻认识到共产党以及他现在这个专制制度的本质，就是说也有一部分人是态度表示非常坚决。
那么我们当时就着重给他们这个介绍，就是说从现在来看，就是比较这个前瞻性的看到了这个共产党他所要采取的立场，就是他在没有强大的压力下，在这个反对派没有团结的前提下，在这个香港全社会没有充分动员起来的情况下，他是不会轻易让步，这是他的这个统治制度的本质所决定的。但是当时香港各界朋友不是很认同，至少他们不愿意往这方向去想，他们不愿意去想中央那边会有一个就是说给他们一个很不好的这么一种状况。然后这个回到欧洲以后呢，我在我的能力范围之内，就是想去串联各地的这个香港社团，让他们提前动手，提前做准备，可能要有一场这个抗争运动，可能要有一场影响这个中国甚至亚洲甚至范围甚至范围更广的这个运动会在香港发生。但我感觉他们一直是抱一个比较这个消极的态度，实际上觉着中央不会怎么样，这个多少会让步或者怎么样。同时呢，我也就是说向他们表示，我们可以为他们做一些在他们与欧美政府之间的沟通工作，让他们提前做准备。后来有曾有两个就是有两他们派出过两个小型代表团，还是私人旅游性质的，去到欧洲去走过两次，但是他们因为这个各派立场也不是很协调，所以我觉得他们并没有做充分的准备，没有做充分准备就是没有接受八九的教训，而且如果共产党稍微有点放松的话，其实范林肯定是会分裂的。但没想到共产党连这一点这个缝隙都没有给，最后使得香港的学生觉得你偌大的一个政府，偌大的一个国家，最后搞文字游戏，这么这个在举世面前许诺的东西你都不做，所以学生走到第一线，最后走到现在所有的这个就是把范民给逼到一起，然后这个局面失控，所以他们现在非常需要外界的支持。好，那好，谢谢谢谢。
你不没
讲的特别，我还有一分钟是吧？
对对对，
这个然后我再简单的介绍一下，就是刚才有个李先生说这个我们现在能做什么，这个我们需要做什么。他说这个每个人发 email 就是通过自己的方式
请发。
我们实际上这个工作在很早以前就是已经开始做了，做了有很多年了。那么现在我们自己所能掌握的这个就是 email 信箱已经将近上千个，而且不停的有人在做这方面工作，就是在做信访。
好的，
好，谢谢。
这个我们这个联席会从去年联席会也就决定要重视这网络工作，其实洪宽提醒我都有十年了，我一直没太重视，但从去年咱们比较重视做这网络工作。首先这个我的这个 Facebook 做得很成功，现在可能有1000多万人在上面，而且大部分是在亚洲，在中国那边，因为我就是用中文嘛。这个咱们及时把一些想法把一些信息通过这个 Facebook 传给香港那边的朋友，在我注意到他们在政策上，在一些想法上，最近这一段时间，战中这一个多月，他们进步非常快，基本上跟着咱们的思路走，这样呢，少犯错误，这很重要，所以这个运动有时候咱们海外就是关键时刻要起作用。64的时候，说实话，海外的民运就没有对国内起任何作用，咱们现在呢？人家会小看咱们，你们算什么？三五个人又没钱又没什么的，但是咱们通过这些免费的这个，像 Facebook 这种传播最先进的传播手段，确实很管用。洪宽10多年前提醒我，非常有道理。我就补充这么一句。
sentences to sum up every keynote speaker's speech. And Mr. Wang, our keynote speaker, said that he had frequent contact with people in Hong Kong before those demonstrations occurred. And he offered assistance to them to liaison with the Parliament of Political Forces in Europe. And finally, he called for supporting of Hong Kong's. Secondly, he said that the Hong Kong's movement is growing because of the Chinese government's stupidity in you know, dealing with the movement. And thirdly, he said that we should support Hong Kong's movement by using the internet as the tools. And Mr. Wei Jingxian's speech summed up Mr. Wen's speech and stressing on the pro-democracy movement and should be stand out and stand up at the critical historical turning point. And he also called for using all kinds of you know, contemporary communication tools to unify the movement to speed up the process in democratizing China. And our next speaker is Mr. Xiang Lin, and my longtime friend. And Mr. Xiang would also give us a speech about Hong Kong. 这位向明先生是来自这个魏京生基金会和中国民族这个联盟的这个就是说日本分，所以呢他是把这个最新的这个民主运动在香港和日本方面的情况给大家做一个汇报，谢谢。去年年底。
是这个魏京松先生的这个指派，王明先生回到北京时派，先去这个香港去考察，然后跟各界交流。王明先生回到欧洲之后，就给我发信息说，魏先生希望我也能够参与这个香港的一些商业工作。然后从那开始呢，我就考虑用什么方式做比较好，然后。 今年3月份，因为在那之前到3月之前还没有开始，我这边没有正式行动。3月份我去欧洲跟王峰先生讨论，我说我个人认为，只在香港做，我们去一趟的话，有可能比较弱。然后我想怎么做，港台澳，包括各国都给他动员起来。所以说从那之后呢，我主要做的是台湾。 澳门、香港这三个方面的联系工作，就是在泰国呀、在台湾，就是台湾那个太阳花学运的时候，我去台湾参加了他们这些，当然我是比较秘密的，因为如果让低调，因为当他们如果知道的话，我怕对他们运动带来一些不太负面的，还有我们跟台湾政府的关系有可能就比较微妙。 然后，但是呢，我跟他们一些台湾搞这些，民主运动或者从事人权工作的朋友，我就提醒他们，台湾的问题，香港的问题。但是呢，当时呢，他们对香港的这个问题呢，一点都没有反应。但是呢，我非常热切的多次跟他们提醒，他们开始动起来了。澳门的朋友也是，澳门的朋友一开始也是没有太大太强的感觉。 但是呢，我们得到别的方面的信息，中共对这个香港战争的问题是最关心了。哎，中共关心、中共担心的问题，那就是我们应该做的问题。所以说，通过几次见面，他们来日本或者我去别的地方跟他们沟通之后，在差不多5月份的时候，他们都已经统一思想了。然后在这个七一之前呢，各国的朋友。 都去的这个参加这个七一的游行，包括澳门呀、台湾的朋友都去了。当时我一开始我也打算去，但是呢，我6月中旬以后我得到的信息是，一开始说是今年7月1号战争，6月中旬得到的信息是今年7月1号不会战争。 然后呢，我怕我去了之后第二次真正战争的时候我就进不去了，所以说我就延迟，就是那个，但是呢有个什么时间的问题，因为现在开始战争了，因为我要参加这个会议，所以说我没办法去香港了。但是呢这些朋友们都给动员起来了，在香港战争之后，我的澳门的朋友、香港的朋友，这些人都是一直从事这些民运或者这个人权工作的，而且都有一定的知名度的，他们也都是比较静悄悄的、不声张的进去，怕被中共说跟国外勾结。因为香港的民主派很有意思，他实际上又希望我们关心他们，但是呢因为他们还要照顾到香港的选民，香港的选民怕被扣帽子。当然了，如果说我们太公开的去支持他们，我也怕吓到他们的支持者，所以说我们都是很秘密，但是表达魏先生和我们的海外的民运对香港战争的支持，跟各派都有打交道。就像王先生提到了，香港现在民主派里分成好几派，而且民主派之间的斗争已经超过，就是几个派的斗争了，已经超过跟中共的斗争了。他们主要的精力就是弄对方，包括这一次签名这个就是对中共的什么谴责什么的，有你这个派挂了名我就不挂。我想陈先生应该很了解这方面，但是呢我们也跟他提示说，大家在战争的问题上不要分得这么清楚。但是呢这一次歪打正着了，是让学生先搞起来了，学生先搞起来了，逼的民主派的大家只好跟在学生的后边，他们OK， 只好跟在学生后边，对不对？这反而造成了一个很好的局面。哎，我记得刚才这个师兄问我说，我怎么看香港这个问题的结局？我个人看法，中共只敢镇压大陆老百姓，为什么？我们大陆老百姓是奴隶，奴性太强了，对不对？所以他只敢镇压我们。对于香港，哪怕是澳门，虽然澳门已经通过23条了，他们都不敢像当年对于八九学院一样的镇压。这就意味着什么呢？这场战争我们有可能是胜利的。以什么姿态？我们不可能全盘胜利，为什么？不，中共不可能一步到位让你实现普选，但是我们能做到哪一点？打掉一个狗腿子，就梁振英。然后呢，第一打掉狗腿子，第二中共会让步到什么位置呢？我们再重新商量。中共的计划策略是拖时间，从97拖到2007，2007年时候他许愿是2017年正式选举。这次香港人为什么这么愤怒呢？我已经被你骗了很多年了，你最后跟我说真正的普选就是这个结果，他这个是个什么结果呢？就是1200个人一开始是选举委员会，就是说可以提名了，但是呢我们这1200个人来选你，这1200个人呢大多数是中共操纵，可以操控的。然后他现在反过来了，好，你要投票权 OK， 350万都有投票权啊，但是我这1200个人呢成了提名委员会了，提名委员会，而且门槛高了，过去是上一届是8个人，这个1/8的人通过，你就有资格当候选人了，候选人。然后这一次
半数
一半，等于说是一个倒退，你香港人有那么傻吗？对不对？所以说这一次运动，中共我认为中共不敢像64那样镇压，当然他会搞一些小动作，对吧？但香港人呢也很聪明，我们相信香港人的智慧，而且香港是打不垮的。为什么打不垮？香港的2/3人都是怎么去的香港？
对，
都是逃离中共去的。他们会愿意回到中共吗？不会。中共敢杀那么多香港人吗？ 我相信他不会的。
好，现在我们最后一位这个讲英语的朋友已经离开了会场，所以我不用用三句话来这个 sum up。 那个我们刚才向林先生给我们讲解了他怎么被魏金生先生派遣到这个香港、澳门、台湾去直接这个 take liaison job 去这个非常低调的去发动这个香港人民这个澳门这个台湾参与台湾人民的这个就是这种民主运动。那么最后他做出了一个预测对这个运动的预测，而且呢做出了非常审慎的估计，就是可能这个运动会获得有限的成功。这个I promised everybody that I would use three sentences to sum up the speech. And that is three sentences. Number one, and Mr. Xiang from Japan and was dispatched secretly by Mr. Wei Jingsheng to Hong Kong since last March. And he took, number two, he took a very low profile and to get commingled with those people and to take his liaison job. Number three, he gave us a very cautious prediction that people in Hong Kong may achieve limited success. They may kick out Mr. Liang Jianying, the chief of Hong Kong, and that's what he told us, the message he brought to us. Our next speaker is Mr. I'm sorry. And Mr. Qingbao. And Mr. Qingbao will give us 5 minutes speech. With our class.
Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. My name is Wei Pingqing. Come from Hubei Province, China. Some people call me Qingbao. Yeah. 13,000 followers, but in Twitter, I just 2,000 followers, so welcome, follow me. Thank you. Maybe some people will ask me, today is not raining, right? Yeah, this is an umbrella. In Hong Kong now, umbrella is not a movement, it's revolution. Yeah, just like Mr. Lee said, we like revolution. Umbrella revolution now in Hong Kong. So, thanks everyone here support human rights and democracy in Hong Kong. 2 days before, the Chinese government is his 65th birthday to 1.3 billion Chinese people. It's not only the longest public holiday, but also the painful memory day. In the past 65 years, over 30 million Chinese people died because of hunger and other reasons. Today, our people say, human rights, no without a border. But I think Chinese people will know. Chinese people have no human rights. We work hard, pay high taxes, but no benefits. It's not unfair. China now is an unfair country in the world. Last year, China's GDP is the number two in the world. The government become more power. So many capitalists and their government come from Europe and other government do business with Chinese government. They can get money. But as a young man come from China, today in US Congress, I will tell I have to remind President Obama and all of the Western world. Today you've got money with the Chinese government. You will pay more money in the future. Yesterday, a Hong Kong citizen told me he is very proud of the umbrella revolution, but he is afraid the government will attack them. So I think all the people in the world who love peace need to support Hong Kong. Hong Kong citizens need real democracy, need real freedom. We are not alone. Chinese people and other people in the world, we need to work together and one party rule by CCP, and we need to build a new democracy China. We're looking forward this day, and I think, I'm sure that this day will come soon. That's all, thank you so much. Thank you.
国语吗？啊，都懂了，那就好了。那就 one language。
OK。
大家知道我在联席会议啊，都是每年都会来，几乎了，在这儿。
嗯。
一二一三一四，在那里一四年。香港是我的故乡，啊，我出生在香港。现在看到的香港问题，其实自己呢，在多年前，甚至在1997的回归那年，已经有很多朋友，啊，我自己也是，会看到、顾及到有这么一天，一国两制行不通的，是不是？要是一国两制能行得通，你一个 family 都可以两制，那就乱了，是吧？所以大家都应该知道。所以现在的问题啊，是很就具体了，矛盾。香港人也是经历过这儿回归啊，所谓回归1997以后到现在，矛盾是爆发了。
是。
这个问题爆发了，那当然过程是很复杂的，是吧？首先，共产党要统治过去在英殖民地受英文教育那些人的思想，那是很难的。英国在那统治了150年之多。我每次回香港，我的简单的方式不用测试的，你不用去问，你问谁呀、啊？你问有一些政客啊，我就说那议员的什么，那都是另一个一个说法都不一样。你最有办法就问出租司机，坐车，兄弟怎么样啊？最近那个 feedback 那个 answer 是最清楚的啊，不行，不好啊，没。那怎么不好啊？啊，谁谁谁又出来麻烦了啊？这样子，所以一路上呢，那个消息是最灵通的。目前的情况，大家看到了，昨天我也呼吁了一下，啊，那个很多年轻人、学生就过来了，有好几十个，那就到这里，啊，那跟那个国会议员们呢都啊反映了情形。也接受了我们的一个信息，民运朋友的信息。目前香港所看到的有一些是现象，但有一些真实的，像老魏说的，那还是很多，就是包括港人呢也不一定知道的。香港人是很善良的，很善良，不想多事，不关这一事不会问的。所以现在这次香港人跑出来这个情况呢，是逼得没法弄了，没法走了，没法过了，是逼出来的。所以在这个问题上呢，我说什么呢，就说还是要大家关注香港问题，像我们的民运朋友在这里关注一个什么，支持什么。刚才斯诺啊那个向林啊等等啊，都说了，老魏也说了，是吧？要看，要给他们一个 思想理念上的一个那个贡献，就要开解他们的，不是说今天是什么就说什么，明天是什么又说什么，是吧？我是做事情的人，老魏知道，我不一般来说我都不爱说，因为说的有些情况呢就没有意思，还说的是没有意思，还在做，还做的具体的怎么做啊？联席会议这个平台这个组织啊，那个在座的都是方方面面的朋友，有些新面孔也不认识，但是来到这里关注听分享一些信息，这是很重要，然后再制定。刚才斯诺说的一句话我很认同，就是每个人都着重从自己的行动去做起，大家做一点，世界就会更美好。我今天不准备报告很多事情，因为现在那个各种那个平台啊、信息啊都很多，你我这一说下分钟就不是那么忙事，好吧？
谢谢。
Thank you again. Three points. I'm from Hong Kong. No Hong Kong. I hope everybody to support Hong Kong. That's right. And 唐元俊先生。
唐主席，
这个中国民主党这个美东分上的名，
算了，点点是加
油。很高兴啊，这次来参加这个老魏这个分会。刚才提到这个香港这个战中啊，这个运动，我个人看法简单化，我个人看法呢，这个中共这次呢，他不会。这可能性很小，但是他一定会有这个应对的这个手段。我们知道这个89年那个这个天安门那个学生运动，他们是用的这个赤裸裸的用这个坦克机关枪屠杀这个北京学生和市民啊，把一场民主运动镇压下去。为什么能镇压下去？因为邓小平掌握了这个我们这个这个民族的一些这个特点，他认为能镇压下去。今天呢，这个共产党他们也会做这个这方面的这个研究准备啊。香港，它这个整个这个政治文化，整个这个历史，这个发展历史是跟中国大陆是完全不一样的。所以说，港人的这种特点，不是现在这个中国大陆的这个人民所具有的。他这个公民社会的成长的阶段也是很高的。而且是很完备的一个公民社会，而中国大陆呢没有经过这个阶段，所以人民的选择很重要。就是提出这个就是这样一个命题，就是人民的选择，如果选择屈服或者选择这个抗争，现在的香港人民呢选择的是抗争，他们一直会持续下去。所以共产党呢，他也在不断的调整他的手段来化解对针对他的这个挑战。所以说下一步我们要观察的就是中共在香港，他或许是用这个民粹的手段啊，或者是操纵这个民间社会啊，搞这个群众运动来反对，或者是用这个警察能镇压能这个压制的时候他会用警察不能压制的时候呢，他一定会用这个配合这个统战，配合这个用香港这个设立一个危局哈，用这些来这个要挟这个香港港人，大多数港人来瓦解这场运动，这个可能性是很大的。我个人的观察就是这样，谢谢大家。
One sentence, I don't think this time the Chinese government would repeat the Tiananmen Square massacre by using tanks to suppress Hong Kong, but however they would do something nasty.Okay, and we have 5 more minutes, and we have, come on, hopefully 1 minute.
Okay, 1 minute.
我们呢，这个西藏人这么支持这个香港的这个部分啊，本来是我在前一段那个发言的时候有讲，但是呢，那个时间呢有限的，所以我就没讲。但是我们那当然这个是哪里有这个独裁，哪里有压迫，那当然有哪里有反抗的。所谓共产党的这个什么压迫也好，那是 人权局是有布什的，但是一个最简单的这个布什假证嘛，法言呐、啊、什么选举啊，这些都是我们当然支持这个香港的这个运动。西藏的现在维面的这个社区里面也很多人，其实只能有这个 Facebook 上的一个或者是 email 啊，或者网络上，即使支持这个香港，但是我觉得这些做的还不够。那怎么做呢？也拿不出来一个主意。但是呢，这些做的我觉得现在很不够。另外的一个挑战呢，刚才王先生也讲的一样，西藏社区来说的话，西藏流亡政府很尴尬。他们怎么尴尬呢？因为是西藏流亡政府要中共谈判，中共谈判的前提条件就是呢，中共宪法框架之内，中共宪法框架之内要民族区域自治要完善。哎，就是这一段，如果这个民族区域自治，中共宪法框架之内的民族区域自治，哎，共产党就那个贯彻落实的话，哎，说他们的话，那就 OK 了。但是香港的一国两制度现在已经到这个地步的时候，中国宪法框架之内的民族区域自治法
不行，
怎么能行呢？
不行，
我们就是强烈的反对。
嗯，
因为中共宪法框架之内，中共的宪法它不是一个民主的宪法，
是，
它已经出卖了我们的人的这个灵魂。谁先承认这个中共的宪法的时候呢，我们就这样反对。流亡政府的这种提法是政治的最基本的这个底线都没有了，已经就承认了中共宪法框架之内，这个怎么能行得通呢？这一点上我们可以说，香港的这个运动不仅仅是香港起了很大的一个鼓励啊，但是我们西藏流亡政府也，我希望香港的这个运动这个给他做一个开局吧，我们的这种给他应该有一个想法。谢谢，我敬你。